Well, we're heading over to see young Stuart and Cedar over there, the FlowHive boys. And we thought, hell, what a good opportunity to harvest some of our own honey. So let's see what Mother's first flow looks like. The girls are a little bit agitated because we've just been playing around here doing a bit of an inspection, but that's all good. So we'll just take our little shelf off. And this is pretty cool because this is the modern version. You can actually sit that on there, create yourself a little shelf. Pull our little plug out. Does it go that way or the other way? Must go the other way. Like that, I reckon. Like that. Then you got to pull off this little bit up here. Have a look at this. And then there's a little cap in the top of this one that you pull out as well. Cool. Look at us go. And then we put our flow bar in. I guess you just go down, do you? Or up. Here it's jumped.
No, I think you have to go right in.
I did. I don't know. I don't want to break Mother's hive. Do you think we better go and look at the directions?
I think you're just going to have to force it.
Okay. You can talk to, you can talk to your mother if I wreck it up. Here we go. Look at that. Oh my God.
That is pretty cool.
That is pretty amazing. I haven't told the bush bee man's wife yet that we might actually sell her honey. Mate, that looks incredible. How cool is that?
What are we going to call it?
I think we might have to call it Mother's First Flow. Something along those lines anyway. Bloody clever. Many a year and a sleepless night, I think, to make this work. And how beautiful is that? How lucky are we got people like that in the beekeeping world that are persistent enough to create a product that you can sit here without even a bee suit on, no extracting equipment, honey straight from hell, straight from your hive to your blooming kitchen table. Man, I tell you what, or in this case, maybe we'll mail it to you. Good run with our FlowHive in the backyard. We better go and see the boys at Make Them. So we're actually heading up to Byron Bay to meet the inventors of this FlowHive genius. Is genius a word? Anyway, it's a genius invention. We got the back stairs extended. Does that mean we're up the butthole of the plane?
Hang on, where did you think we were?
Oh, I thought we should go down to Brisbane. That was good. This is pretty shabby. Yeah.
We're going to Brisbane in the car, Dad.
Yeah, okay. I didn't want to pay that much attention. I was getting all cocky thinking Adelaide was better than Brisbane. There we go. Only the gold.
Yeah, we're going to Brisbane later in the week. We're going to Byron. We're going to Byron first.
So the technique, wipe its nose and then slide it under.
That's it, go.
Beautiful, he's got
nearly.
It.
Yeah, you got 8.2.
Yeah, 8.2. Well, did you ever think you'd be standing here on the side of the mountain making this actually happen? Like back when the dream was first born in the shed and you guys were, basically trying to work out how to harvest honey without an extractor.
Oh, it definitely is surreal, and I never get sick of watching this process actually, because it's kind of mesmerizing. It's like, well, hang on, all I've done is turn this handle, yet the produce is just flowing out just beautifully as we speak. Honey is always different. It's just kind of a magical process. And, you know, thanks to the bees, they often make more honey than they need, and we can share some too.
When Cedar first said to me, you know, we've got to figure out a way to get honey out of a hive without opening the hive up, he was covered in sweat and and stings from a pretty rough day, and, you know, like a summer's day up here in the humid northern rivers. So part of the motivation was, I don't want to do this sort of work. It's backbreaking. It's
That's fair enough.
You get stung. It's hard yakka for, you know, just selling honey in health food stores and stuff like that. That was a motivation, but I think always for you was thought, what if we could? Wouldn't that be amazing? You know, and for me it was, wow, if we could, that'd be a, you know, an amazing bit of inventing to play with.
So that process, that when I would take the bucket of honey to the shop to sell, I'd almost be sad to let it go because there was so much effort that it went into harvesting that honey, and it just felt like a crime to sell it for $100 a bucket.
Yeah,
you know? So that's where the idea came from. Well, hang on, can't we just have a tap on the hive where the bees can do their thing? We don't have to disturb them. I had pretty angry bees at the time. Lots would die and all of that in the whole process. And I thought, can't we just like tap it out while the bees do their thing into a jar? So that's what sparked a decade-long process, which my father joined in on, and we ended up just testing prototype after prototype. Now, I was a paragliding instructor at the time, so I had another way to make a meek income. Inventing was a long-winded process where, for instance, we were trying to invent a way to decap the frames inside the hive. We would get some pre-made honeycomb cells and cover them in different things like silicon, put it in there and see if all the bees won't be able to stick to silicon. They won't be able to cap it, so therefore we could harvest it when it, you know? That didn't work, I just connected straight to it. From there, other experiments, like actually having a capping section inside the hive, which moved away from the frame, and that didn't work very well either.
That got stuck when it moved apart, or what was the go?
It's just clumsy to try and get that movement happening with a really fine piece of capping stuff inside the hive.
Yeah, that makes sense.
For a while, we were trying to get honey out of hexagon-shaped cells. Honey is this quite thick liquid, and you cut the capping off and you cut the back off and you've got these hexagon cells, you tip them up this way, it really doesn't want to come out still. The surface tension and viscosity just holds it in there. You can only really harvest nectar like that. So after making like piston plungers that go down cells, just like casting things in my shed, I lived in that shed paying, you know, a little bit of rent each week and collecting kind of stuff from the side of the road to make stuff out of.
That's a good box. Stop.
Exactly. Everything. The drill I used to make many of the first prototypes, I got from the side of the road and got other batteries out of other things and repacked it, you know.
Made it happen.
Make it happen like that.
Awesome.
So it was a long process of trying and failing and trying and failing. But one of the key moments was I woke up one morning and went, hang on, it doesn't have to be hexagon cells anymore. All the time, it could be hexagon cells when the bees fill it, and then like come apart into two different shapes that aren't hexagons. That was more of a sideways movement. So I was, if you like, doing hexagon cells that came apart that way. So I cut that, weeks of like cutting with a knife, different shapes.
Oh man!
And then I got car tire inner tube, right? And I made a diaphragm and a suction hose. And when you sucked on the hose, the two parts came apart. And you know what? That actually worked.
Unreal.
And thought, wow, this could actually work. And then my dad, after a couple of strong coffees one day, went, hang on, instead of going sideways, why don't we go this way? And I went, oh, of course.
Even easier.
We rushed into the shed, wouldn't use up so much space in the hive. The whole thing's just a half cell movement instead of like a whole, you know,
squash
12, 13 millimeters cells, just infinitely easier.
Yeah, sure.
So that was what became the method of harvesting. And that the first amount we harvested was actually just a single cell line. And the way it worked is we displaced just half a cell upwards, that single cell line. And we did that in the workshop, which is the shed I lived in. And we just collected in a measuring flask how much honey came out.
One row.
And we went, hang on a second, if you multiply that by all of the cells in the frame, this is actually going to be a really good method to efficiently harvesting all the honey in the frame.
Oh, what a process. How long, I mean, that is pretty mind-blowing to think about.
There's so much in that, you know, because there's okay, we figured it out on paper, but then how do you build it? Like, how are you going to move those six segments? So we thought, oh yeah, cam, like you get in a car. So we had a local Lismore business making up this 40-lobe cam for us. Can't imagine that's going to be a commercial success. Just the cam was going to cost us that. So we had so much to figure out in terms of how the whole thing was going to work. And that, I mean, one brilliant thing was, well, we need ends on this. Yeah, well, it's okay to have figured out the guts of it. And seeds that we thought, why not make the ends clear? And then that becomes the window. It's like, wow. Which suddenly opened up a whole different vista that beekeepers hadn't had before, and that is looking down between the frames, watching the bees work, and even watching them work down a cell.
It didn't occur to us that you'd get two different flavours from two different frames.
No, we didn't know that.
The joy of isolating flavours of honey was going to be one of the things that people really rave about.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, sometimes you can get honey that you can't even see through. It's black.
I think the other thing that I'm just standing here thinking, we're actually harvesting honey out of an active beehive.
Yes, right.
We're quite a lot of beehives, as a matter of fact. They haven't even said hello at all. There hasn't been one that's come up and said hello to us.
That's created this experience, which so many families are really enjoying, where you can just sit here like this and enjoy tasting the honey and all of that.
That's always interesting, that thought pattern. I grew up on the farm with my dad and trying to become my own man. How did that go, that whole father-son dynamic? And you guys seem like pretty good together. I think it adds to it in a lot of ways, because there's sometimes you can talk to each other in like a father-son relationship that you can't do if you're just sort of like solely business partners.
Yeah, look, we've always had a great relationship. My dad's a top bloke, and he's been a bit of a model for me in terms of communicating and how to be in the world. I actually said that if business gets in the way of our relationship, I'd give it all away.
Unreal. That is awesome. That is a good thing.
Yeah. Even if the whole thing failed, you know, after 10 years we just gave up, it still would be a success from my point of view, because spending time with the way we click and the ideas we have and the laughter and the craziness for me, a lot of admiration at the effort Cedar puts in. When he, you know, dog at a bone doesn't describe it, probably bee on a bush is a bit, you know. So I admire his tenacity and drive.
You get that little taste of success and you're like, I'm close, it's going to happen.
Funny thing, I think my family, while they appreciate that quality, it's also very annoying that they can be yelling at me for some time before I even notice. Yep. So I think I inherited that.
I remember when my kids were little and they'd say, Dad, can you come and do something? I said, I'll be there in a minute. And then their comeback was, is it one of your minutes or one of Mum's minutes? How long are you going to be?
Most people make the mistake of packing it too early.
Just like that.
Oh, thank you. Isn't that nice? Any chance to kick me? Yeah. Jeez, I tell you what.
Some people can't work out where the handle is, but there it is.
Yeah.
It's a good handle.
Good handle.
And the windows can be handles too, but it's nice lifting in a longitudinal direction, really. I always like to just tip it up so you don't squash the bees. And all of these frames have had no foundation. And that's the way we roll, because it's just easier. Sometimes they get bent, you've got to fix that up, but I find that easier than spending my nights waxing and wiring.
Imagine the beginning of crowdfunding. All of a sudden we're in the position to have to make 25,000 beehives. And the suppliers were saying, well, we just can't get you that much foundation. But have you heard about natural frames?
Yeah.
Well, I hadn't then.
You know the FlowHive that we got there, you had the little bead to help them go in there?
Need that bar. Naturally drawn isn't always fixed at the sides well, so you have to be careful how you tip them over.
Right.
And do that sort of thing.
Yep, and of course as they go further along,
it's a beautiful example of naturally drawn comb, look at that.
It's awesome.
And they get to size the cells, look, they've done a big here, small here, because that's what they wanted to do. They'll often store bigger cells where they want to do honey and smaller where they want to do brood. And that's why with the FlowHive we made the frames more this size, honey storage size. We tried to be just under drones, so we're less likely to get any type of brood in them.
Yeah, okay, just in case she decides to get upstairs.
Lots of beekeepers don't use an excluder at all, and they just run it like that. And you can do that a little bit more easily with the flow frames if you choose to, because the flow frames are just not the right size for worker brood. But,
yeah,
but
right.
You know, then you're chasing the queen around two boxes or more rather than just one and all that.
If we put a little bracket here, it's a nice little chill use.
Then you can hang the frame there.
And that's a nice little doubles as a frame rest.
Oh, look at that.
Here's one fanning its Nazanoff gland. See its tail bent down, and it's opening up that little segment at the back. Its Nazanoff gland. It's aware there's a disturbance, and it's wanting to say, here's the hive, here's the hive.
There you go. That, out of my ignorance, I thought that was the fanning. I thought it was about sending the queen's pheromone.
So this one here is fanning just for air movement because it's not exposing that gland. But that one is exposing the gland. The things I've learnt from the world, from our customers, from this huge audience of beekeepers all around the world is amazing.
It is. It is. And the love of the bee is around the whole planet. It sort of transcends all of, I guess, all of the human stuff that goes on, because bees are a great leveller, for want of a better way of putting it.
From square one, we really did get the message that people wanted more education. So we started making video content and putting it out there. I was jumping in front of the camera like I still do every week to answer questions. Quickly recognised that people actually wanted a more structured course. So what we put together at thebeekeeper.org is a collaboration of experts from all around the world to make high quality training material. And people are just loving it. And one of the best things about it is it's also a fundraiser. And we've planted over 1 million trees last year. Yeah. And the idea is we create literally billions of safe blossoms for the bees to forage on.
Oh, that's a cool idea.
So we're planting trees locally, nationally, internationally. And, you know, everyone agrees we need to save the bees. And the way we do that is with more habitat.
I guess once you get a little bit more serious about it, you actually start noticing what's happening around you in a broader sense. Mm. Like, I don't know how you guys get on, but when you're driving along, you go, that's flowering. Oh, that, I wonder if there's going to be more in the paddock, or, you know, like, is it just on the side of the road because you've got a little bit more weeds now, a bit more rain, and then your partner in the car's going, watch me, you're driving! Or is that just me?
No, that's the beekeeper.
A really amazing thing for us, watching how our audience has responded to beekeeping, because we get about half new beekeepers. Yeah. And we get these beautiful stories coming back with people saying, oh, I didn't realise that trees even had flowers, and now I've actually converted my whole block to an insecticide-free zone, and I'm sharing all of the honey around, and we're like, yes!
Yeah. Awesome.
This spreading beekeeping around the world not only helps with the plight of the bee, but also this shift in consciousness around how we as humans need to look after the environment, our environment, the very matrix of life that supports us and all life on Earth.